But if you have a couple hundred of them in your document, then this dialogue pops up where it's basically asking the user, this is slow, do you want to actually not type it as a children, then it's going to be faster. And yeah, this is not such a good user experience, I think. So this is the performance problem that we are trying to address here. And what is the solution going to look like? So the basic idea is that we don't want to hide the renders in the document model, but instead hide them in the document view, actually, so that the view setting is actually a view setting. And basically that means in the layout. So now we want it's not conceptually really that difficult. It's just this additional data type for a mesh paradigm that contains a bunch of things like some listeners, so that it can connect to multiple nodes, which I'm going to describe in detail in a bit, and then a vector of text ranges that are extents that describe which parts of these paragraphs are deleted and which are visible, and then the merge text of the of all of these paragraphs, so that is only the text that is actually visible. And then we need a couple of pointers, like a pointer to the text node that contains the paragraph properties that are going to be applied to this merged layout frame, and pointer to the first node, which is not necessarily the same as one that has a paragraph. Because the paragraph properties come from the first node that is not completely empty. And then we also need the last node. So this doesn't look actually all that difficult. The difficulty in this change is then to actually make use of this data type everywhere that it now needs to use, because as it turns out, there are some invariants that used to be guaranteed by the previous implementation that are now no longer valid, and all the code has to be adapted for these changes. So firstly, we have the previously an invariant that the indexes inside of the text node and the indexes inside of the layout frame, which is called the SW text frame, are basically identical. So the text frame would contain numerous text portions, line portions, etc., that refer to parts of the text of the paragraph, and the indexes there are 32-bit integers, and they would just indexes into the string that is contained in the text node. What we need now is a bit of an indirection, where the text frame now contains one of these merge par objects, and this firstly contains this vector of extents that is the invisible text. So here in this example we have this where second merge is deleted, so it's not visible. So we have here extends from the start of the paragraph until index 3 is visible, and index 7 until the end of the paragraph is visible, And yeah, we have the merged text, that's still visible here in the merged paragraph. And then we have these portions of the text frame. They now have indexes that point into the merged text instead of the known text. And there is a data type here, text frame index, that is used for these indexes that point into the text frame. And if we want to convert between these frame indexes and the indexes that are used inside of the document wall area, which is usually some position SW index, then we need to use the extensive information in the merge error to do a mapping. And yeah, this needs to be done everywhere where there is some access from the model into the layout or the other way around. So the other invariant that is no longer valid is that previously we had this relationship between the text log and the text frames that was 1 to n. So one text log can have multiple text frames. So for example, if you have so much text in the paragraph that it doesn't fit on one page, you get one text frame per page. And these text frames also connect to their text node via this SW modified SW client listener mechanism that Björn talked about yesterday in great detail. And yeah, every text frame always has a unique text node that it connects with. Now with the merge bar, what we actually have is an end-to-end relationship. So in this example, we would have some delete track change that starts in the first text node and ends in the last text node. So all of these three text nodes are basically connected and should be displayed in the view as one text frame, as one paragraph. And so what do we need to do that? We have in the text frame only an SW client, which has this limitation that it can only listen at one SW modifier at a time. So what we have added there is this writing multi-listener object, which is an indirectional mechanism that Björn has added, and that can be used to connect to multiple SW modifier objects. So we connect basically every one of these text frames, which every one of these three text nodes. And the multi-listener will directly receive the events that are sent by the text node. It will then forward them to the text frame. With all this we have this end-to-end relationship. And now the problem is that there are a lot of places that in the code that ask for the text node that is connected to the current text frame, and yeah, this then needs to be changed. So much for the general idea of the solution, and now come to the actual implementation that we have already started. So this is basically proceeding in four larger milestones. And the first one is that we need to adapt the text formatting layout itself so that it makes use of the merge paragraph second milestone was that the document core, the writer core code needs to be adapted to create the layout properly so that it's looks right when you load a document or when you edit it and so on. The third step is to fix the accessibility and adapt it to the new requirements and also various things in the document that are numbered. And then we have some catch-all diverse issues and not so important yet features that are going to be the subject of the fourth milestone. And so about the text packet itself. So the changes there are so much large, but in many parts quite superficial or simple. There are some areas where larger changes to algorithms are needed. So the first obvious thing that we need is a place to store this view setting, whether we want to show our header headlines. And previously for this, the document model, the redline manager there was used. But of course, we want to get away from using the document model for this. So, the obvious place to store this setting would be the view shell, but as it turns out, it's better to use the root frame, which is the root class of the entire layout, to store it, because as it turns out, we can have multiple view shells for a writer document, but we cannot have multiple layouts currently, because all of the view shells actually share one layout. This is something that could, of course, be improved, but that would be for a different project. And then most of the changes are going to were happening in the text frame class itself, where it is now using this merge paragraph dataset for all sorts of invalidations and whatnot to reformat and repaint the current part of the frame when something is changing in the document, like the user edits it. Lots of other smaller changes there. It has drawn quite a few new functions to do mappings and so on. And then there was this SWScript info class, which I previously barely knew that it existed, but it's actually quite important to the text formatting process because it stores lots of information about what scripts are being used, what parts of the text are being hidden by character attributes and that sort of thing. And that's actually quite a bit confusing because this class contained lots of duplication between static functions and member functions that sort of did the same thing, but it turned out that the static functions were usually called from the document model and the member functions from the text formatting and layout. So yeah, I needed a bit of refactoring and moving things around. Then another area that needed quite large changes was the attribute breaker. That is some three tightly coupled classes that that are used all over the text formatting and the has the same formatting, so it has only one formatting for all of the text inside of it. And the important part there was that we cannot just break into a new text portion every time a red line starts or ends, because then we would have a problem there with the font kerning. So if font kerning only happens inside of a text portion, if you break in one place, then those two characters you cannot get kerning with or a painting implementation then. So the iterator is a bit more complex because it then has to skip over the deleter runs basically and check if the formatting at the other end of it is the same as at the beginning. Happens to end in a different paragraph altogether. There are a lot of places where we had to map between these two index types. So as I said, we now have different types of indexes for the text node and for the text frame. And previously, these were both just 32-bit integers, so there was no annotation or whatever to actually find the places where we need to add calls to these new mapping functions. But it turned out that we can leverage the type system and the compiler there. So Noel Brandon has added this great strong template. Which is basically an integer. It has all the arithmetic operations declared on it, but you can't actually mix a strong int with an ordinary solid 32 operation because that would then cause a compiler error. You have to explicitly convert between the two types everywhere. And so we have added such a strong int for the text frame index and then just converted first all of the class declarations, the header files basically, to just look at which of these functions operate on text frame indexes, convert those, and then we can leverage the compiler and just print an error message at every place in the actual implementations where the index needs to be mapped in either direction. And what's also very nice about this is if we just, that's the first step, just if that's the definition of this text frame index, then we can incrementally convert all the code, so we can have a large, long series of small commits that each compile on their own, and then we can, if we happen to make mistakes somewhere in that certain direction, we can use the git bisect to find it. It's quite useful there. So the last part of it was the problem of the multiple nodes with the end-to-end relationship that is now happening. There are actually a surprising amount of different functions that can be used to retrieve the text node from the text frame. So we have to go through all of them and replace them with different functions. So the new function, so firstly, the most used one is that the text formatting wants to get the formatting properties that are used for the paragraph. So we have a function for that. And in some cases, it's necessary to actually get the first text node. And there are also two special formatting patterns for the page breaks that, for reasons I don't claim to understand, are actually always taken from the first one. The first one is empty in contrast to all the other properties. So for those we have now distinct functions in the text string together. And yeah, of course, then we also need quite often this function to just get the text that is in the text frame. So this merge text in the internal. And yeah, so of course, all of these functions work if the paragraph is merged, then they retrieve the return value from the merged paragraph. And if it isn't merged, then they just work on the way they previously did. So then you see SW modifier to get the stuff and return the text that's inside the text model. What we also need is this new mode for the SW iterator, because there is a lot of code that uses the SW client SW modifier relationship in a way that is not really a textbook example, as I think we discussed yesterday, to just use, grab the text node and iterate over all of its clients of a particular type. So for example, it wants to find or iterate all of the text frames that are registered at a node, and because the relationship between the text node is now indirect, because there is this module listener in the middle between the two, this would break, but we have added this new indirect iteration mode that looks, if the client is a module listener, then checks the type of the object that the motor points to. So that should also work.
We get a bit short of time.
Okay. So this was all in the first milestone, and that was integrated into master already a couple of months ago, but it was not actually enabled. Now the second milestone was to adapt the writer core code to make the basic editing of the document and so on possible, to make the things basically usable. So if you load a document and it has this setting inside of it that says that the red lines are hidden, then we want to initially create the layout already of the merged frames, and this, we need to make some changes, and then we also want to be able to click the item in the menu to switch between the two modes, and then we need to iterate over the entire document and basically create merge frames or delete the old frames and so on. And what's tricky there is that you don't only need to look at the text frames themselves, but there are also other frames connected to the text frames, and these need to be maintained and kept up to date as well. So twice might be anchored at the text frames, so these are the drawing shapes and fine text frames that you can insert. Then also the text frames that may contain footnotes, and the footnote may be deleted and so on. And then right, these not only may be deleted by the red line, but they also may need to be moved from one text frame to the other frame. That's also possible if it happens to be newly merged. And then we have the editing operations in the document model, and these now also need to ensure that the correct frame is invalidated when some text is inserted or deleted, whatever. They also need to move the text frames that are connected to one node to move them to a different node. Say when you join two paragraphs by going to the start of the second one, pressing backspace, that sort of thing. Generally, this was actually the point, the part of the work that took somewhat longer than expected. So finding all of these things and getting them to actually work. The next point then was that the cursor shell is maintaining the view cursors that the user can move around. And of course, in the beginning, it would happen that if you move the delete line, then it didn't visibly move. So we had to change all that stuff so that it jumps over the line. And this is now all connected to the experimental mode. So if you use two options to click this enable experimental mode, then it's going to be enabled. And this is already merged. Master was merged last week. So just two more slides. What's planned for the next milestone is that we need to fix the accessibility, which currently crashes, which is of course currently completely unacceptable. And there are various things in the document that are numbered, footnotes, lists, etc. And these currently display the wrong numbers, so we need to fix them that they can display two different numbers basically. And the fourth milestone is then going to be various things like obscure features like the auto format that is currently making a bit of a mess of things, table of contents, maybe I'm not sure if it actually needs changing. The find and replace may currently not work terribly well. May find things that are deleted but you can't actually see, which is a bit odd. The format paragraph may not be good. I'm not sure what paragraph the result should be actually applied to, but because you only see one of the many text holes, so which text one should the result be applied to? At the end, we hope to be able to get rid of this dialogue actually. Of course, thank you to the city of Munich for sponsoring this work. It wouldn't be possible for us otherwise. And so I'm finally done.